Yes.
Yes. Okay. Hello, everyone, and welcome for today's online startup and academia cooperation online session. And we are happy to see the interest from different countries, both from representatives from startups and incubators and from students and academia. And I saw in the registration that there are participants from Greece, but also from Poland, Latvia, Spain, Luxembourg, and Cyprus, and other countries. So welcome, everyone. Generally, within the framework of the Power Project, that is EU project for the placement opportunities with entrepreneurial reach, we conduct series of online sessions with aim to connect innovative and fast developing businesses with the students. So that means this Power Project is a project that facilitates the establishment of the EU-wide placement ecosystem, which primarily is focused for high impact of the startups. And one of the results of this Power Project that currently is created is the modern user-friendly database where you can get information regarding the startups who are looking for interns for help from different kind of talents, and the database from the students who are looking for internships that they need to during their studies or just for their own development. So this is this project will allow more to explore these new and innovative pathways, how to cooperate between these companies, new companies, and the students during their internships. And so I'm representing here in the project University of Latvia, and I'm very, very happy to meet now in these online sessions with the partners from Greece. So welcome, everyone.
It's great to be here. So who goes next with the introductions? I guess Nikki or Kostas? Or shall we jump into the training?
I think you should start. Hello from me, everyone. I think you can start and introduce yourself. It's the best way to actually to introduce someone.
How many people are we expecting?
Many. I think around 200 registered, but you know, it's academic quarter probably taking place. And Kostas can also have a look at the waiting room and probably accept people.
We have disabled the waiting room now.
So. Everybody is.
So the waiting room is disabled and people are already connecting. Okay. Directly to the session. Okay, great.
I would propose that while waiting, let's give the floor to everybody to introduce themselves and give us some hints about their interests and how we should go, where we should focus the presentation.
Okay, that's a good idea.
If anyone wants to speak, just unmute yourself and start speaking.
So let's start with Dimitrios and continue. Okay.
Right. But I'm the last person in the order of the speakers. But since I'm the host of the call, so my name is Dimitrios Kourtesis. I'm working on new technology product development. I have a background in computer science and software engineering. I'm here today because I've been working with Nikos and with Stefanos, who are also the speakers for today, and Kostas Tramatzas from Alexander Innovation Zone in Thessaloniki for over 3 years now, actually close to 3 years, at OKThess, which is the city's innovation hub, the startup hub, of the region. I'm the program manager of an acceleration program at OKThess. We've supported 91 startups and we have just admitted our 11th cohort of startups, which comprises 16 new startup teams. So over 100 startups supported by OKTHES through a program that includes training, coaching, and networking through with mentors and access to capital. We have a training program that's quite specialized on lean startup methodology. This comes from people who have startup experience ourselves. So we've developed this program with, you know, bringing in lots of the experiences with successes and failures of the past, mostly failures. And our coaching is designed to support teams with applying the methodology. So it's a quite a different program compared to other programs happening elsewhere. Yes, we have a network of mentors. We have also investor demo days, which we organize, where there's teams participating from all around Southeast Europe and venture capital funds and business angel networks from across Southeast Europe. We've done this 5 times. So last time we had 150 one-on-one meetings between venture capital funds and angels and startups. We had 41 startups participating last time. So that's what we do at OKTHES. And I'm also a co-founder of Ideas Forward, which is a technology venture builder set up in Thessaloniki, where we focus on, again, early stage teams, but not as early, not idea stage teams, not as early as OKTHES is you know, the kind of teams OKTHES is working with. And we work with both internal and external ventures. We develop our own technology. So we do our own R&D on some enabling technologies, data analytics, distributed ledger technologies, Internet of Things. That's one thing we do. The second thing is we help companies and founders with product discovery, which is what we'll be talking about today. And also with execution, go-to-market execution, meaning setting up sales, marketing, and investment readiness. So this is why I'm here today. Kostas was very kind to invite us. And we'll look forward to having an interactive session on the startup roadmap. So the floor to my fellow speakers and co-founders today. Nikos?
Yeah, well, hi from me too. Thank you for inviting us in this call. My name is Nikolaos Tsoniotis. I'm a coach at OKTHES too, as Dimitri said, working with startups and applying the lean startup methodology with all of them and helping them make their first steps towards realizing their dreams. I bring with me 13 years of industrial research background in the telecommunications field and another 7 years in research in academia and research institutes. And not to drag the conversation, we combined all that knowledge and experience and failures and some successes we had with Dimitris and Stefanos to create Ideas Forward, and we're looking forward to working with more entrepreneurial ideas in the future.
Okay, my name is Stefanos Tsiakmakis. I'm a PhD engineer, mechanical engineer. I understand energy and transport. Apart from supporting some teams at OKTHES, I don't have anything to add on what the previous speaker said. I'm focusing mainly on more early stage teams. I'm a partner at Ideas Forward together with the two gentlemen, and I'm also running another company, BioCHP, which is a spin-off of the Aristotle University, which develops technology that allows the use of residual biomass for energy production at small scale. So it's hardware, it's energy related and stuff like that. That's all from me.
So, where shall we go from here? I see
It's only 17 participants still.
So
I think we should proceed, actually.
Yes, I think so too.
More people will join later. I was informed that some people have exams. So let's continue. I think it's better if we move on, okay?
All right. Why are we here today? So what's the topic of the whole seminar series? Online sessions on entrepreneurial mindset and crisis management. So entrepreneurial mindset and crisis management, they're both about agility and working with the aim to adjust to what is the context, what is the situation out there, and avoid bias, avoid blindness, and discover the truth, and build your effort accordingly. Us three, by the way, Stefanos, Nikos, and myself, we also launched 2.5 months ago a volunteer initiative called COVID-19 Response Greece, which was about scientists and engineers coming together to provide, to solve problems like the absence of personal protective equipment. In less than a week from starting this this initiative, which is now 260 people and 8 projects running in parallel. So within a week from starting this, we were able to design 2 alternative protective face shields and to have the first 10,000 delivered to the Medical Association of Thessaloniki. So I'm only saying this because the startup way of structuring an effort is one that's helpful not only in launching an entrepreneurial venture, but also in responding to crisis, because it's about being agile. Now, this is some figures from 2018 from the US Small Business Administration. And this was an analysis done to understand what is the survivability of small businesses. And what they came, what the conclusion they arrived to is that a quarter will close within first year, half of them will have closed by year 5, and 3/4 will have closed within the first 10 years. This is again US data, but it's like this everywhere. And this is about new businesses. It's not about startups, because startups, they're not the same thing as any new business. So the definition that Steve Blank gives is that a startup is a temporary organization which is used to search for a repeatable and scalable business model. So yes, there are people, it's an organization, but it's only temporary. We know that this organization is meant to change, to evolve into something different. And the sole function that it serves on the outset is that we use this organization to discover a business model that can be, it's viable, we can repeat it, it works, the numbers work, it will allow a viable business to exist, and it can scale. So it's 2 different things. It's viability, financial viability, and it's also scalability, so the potential to grow very quickly. That's an alternative definition from the founder of Warby Parker, which is one of the most innovative companies in the US, which basically says something very similar, that it's a company that's working to solve a problem where the solution is not obvious and success is not guaranteed. So it goes hand in hand with innovation. What that means is trying out something that's never been tried before, or that's been tried before, but not to the extent that would allow us to, you know, get easily advice on how to set up the business model to have high certainty that this business model would work. So it's not tried before, which means it's it might have high potential and high reward. But innovation is the same thing as risk. It's never been tried before, which means it's high uncertainty and high risk. And the number one reason that startups fail is because, and also speaking from my own bitter experience, is arriving at the conclusion that the market we had in mind isn't as large as what we thought would be. So every startup founder starts with an idea about an opportunity out there, because there would be probably so many people that would be interested in buying a product or service. And after going through the steps in a journey, we only come to realize most times that the market is smaller than we thought. And this journey is unique to each effort. So starting with an idea and arriving at a business that can sustain itself, that's profitable, to sustain itself, that's a very unique thing to each founding team and to each business. Nevertheless, there are some very common phases and some very common challenges, which other people who are much more bright than ourselves have realized and have mapped out, and have pointed out that they can be attacked, they can be managed in the same way. There's lots of best practices that, that we can bring into entrepreneurial effort in 2020. Things have changed. When we no longer have to, you know, discover a process on our own. There's lots of best practices that we can adopt in our effort. So having said that, I'll hand over to Stefanos to talk about the phases in that journey. You need to unmute.
Sorry, I have Nikos here messing with stuff, so I had to mute myself. So as Dimitri said, there are similar steps and some similarities in the path that every idea or project is facing. The main five stages of the roadmap, as we are calling it, is the ideation, is the concepting, the screen, learn, adjust phase, the launch, and the scale up. Initially, we start with an idea. We have a team. We have some visions and dreams. We try to set up some targets, and we have a rough idea about the problem and solution that may fit each other. Then, starting from that, we normally work a little bit more to build some business models, business model canvas and stuff like that, using tools like the business model canvas, etc. We perform some analysis regarding our strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats, etc. Normally, we start building some stuff, and then we should pass to the screen, learn, adjust phase, where we start exposing ourselves to the market, start testing things, and getting feedback from the market. If we do that correctly, we highly increase our chances of being able to move to the next phase, where we should launch a company and go out to the market with a product. Scale up comes later in the process, when you already have your customers, repetitive customers, recurring sales, the business model aspects are crystal clear, and you can set up a business plan as well and start imagining how the future will be, but with solid guesses. Let's see now each stage a little bit more closely. So starting with the ideation. Here, three things are the important: the problem, the competition, and the market. We are going to check each one separately. First, the current trend is that we have understood, in fact, people working on this things that products should be seen as solutions to problems. And all our focus should be in understanding the problem that you are trying to, that we are trying to solve, trying to understand who has this problem, who is the customer, how intense is that problem, and try to support that with relevant data, and instead of just having ideas, etc., etc. So, for example, we need to describe, we need to try to describe the situation faced by potential customer. So if I have a device, if I build a device that reduces the cost of heating, the problem that I'm trying to solve is that in SKG in Thessaloniki, for example, the cost of heating for an apartment is high. And we try to find relevant statistics to understand the numbers around the problem. In a different case, where we build something that reduces the chances of heart attack, we need to understand what is the number of people that die of a heart attack every year. These numbers gives us a sense of how big is the market, yeah? Who has the problem? We need to understand that there are various types of problems, and we like this categorization that the first case is that the problem does not exist, in fact. The problem does not exist in general if people do not actively seek for solutions and stuff like that, or we're going to go into details. But there is a solid chance that the problem we're trying to solve does not exist at all. It's not a problem, yeah? What I mentioned before, that the cost of heating in Thessaloniki is high, it's not the case. And the cost of heating in Thessaloniki is not that high, it's cheap. Then there is the latent problem, where you have the case that the customer has the problem, but they do not acknowledge, they do not see the fact that they have the problem. They do not see it as a problem. You have then the passive problem, where they acknowledge the fact that there is what you are talking about is a problem, but they haven't done anything to solve it. And you can see that if they are not aware of alternatives or other solutions that exist in the market trying to solve the same problem. Then you go to the main two categories of the problem that you would like to work on solving, is the urgent problem and the vision problem. So the first case is that they have the problem, they acknowledge that they have the problem, and they are actively seeking for solutions, but they haven't found any solution that fit their requirements and needs yet. And the last, they have a vision. The vision problem is that they acknowledge the problem and they are working towards solving it. And more than having identified some solutions, they are super willing on paying for solving the problem they are facing. In general, we want to work on problems that belong in the categories 4 or 5. 1, 2, 3, one is definitely not the case if the problem doesn't exist. But for the cases 2 and 3, where people do not really acknowledge the fact that the problem exists, or they do not do anything about that, belongs to a category where you have to educate your customers, which normally comes to a really high cost. Moving to the next slide. So trying to understand the problem, normally you, apart from talking to customers and trying to understand your customer, you come up with alternative solutions on the same problem. Move on to the next slide. I think that we're talking about the competition. Yeah. So here it's important to understand that competitor is anyone who solves the same problem. if I'm building this energy reducing device to reduce my cost of heating in Thessaloniki, whatever, my competitors are not only other companies that building similar devices, but my competitors are is anything that trying to solve the same, it's trying to solve the same problem. So when we are working, going backwards, when we are working to understand a little bit the problem, normally we come up with other alternatives that exist in the market, and we should map them as competition, and we should work on learning from them. Yeah, what a benchmarking chart would be very helpful, as we write here, is similar to the table that we've seen before. It's super useful to have a list of the competition, of your competitors, and the various features that they have. Not technical characteristics, but how they are perceived from the eyes of the customer. It's important to remember here that too much competition or no competition at all is generally a problem. Yeah, too much competition means that you will have to work a lot to invest a lot to differentiate yourself and get to be known by your customers. No competition generally means that this is a good indication that the problem doesn't exist. Next slide and next slide. So, yeah. Now we have seen the problem notion, we have seen the competition. Now we go to see the market. An important notion that you have to remember is that the beachhead market, in fact, is who is the first customers that you're going to address. Yeah, the market can be huge, as we've seen in the previous chart. Go, begin a little bit. Yeah, so here, this is a graph from a really interesting book named Crossing the Chasm by Geoffrey Moore. And in the x-axis, you have different categories of customers. And the c-axis is normally the number, yeah, how big is the market. And we have the early markets, where you initially start with some innovators and early adopters that they lack. They like new stuff, they like new technologies, they like new solutions, and so they are willing to spend a little bit some money to explore various alternatives. And then you have the mainstream market, the early majority, the late majority, and the laggards, who where you have people who are not willing to take any risk to solve any problem. They want to see what other people are doing and act accordingly. In between, you have the chasm. This is the main problem of all startups, because in most cases, you can find some initial adoption and some initial traction from some first customers. But as Dimitri said in the beginning, you need some numbers, yeah, and you can have 1 or 10 or 100 customers, but if you need to go to the thousands, you need to cross this chasm. Move the slides of the beachhead market. So initially it's important to try to understand the different market segments, the different profiles of the customers that you may address, that you can address. And similarly to the competition, build a table, map them, and try to give, not sociologists, to evaluate them on various axes. Yeah, so some parameters that are important is what is their buying power, how easily accessible are they to you, how severe is the problem that they particularly face, reachability is similar to accessibility, how intense is the competition that they perceive, and how easy is to expand to other markets, starting from one particular market to expand to other markets, yeah? So for example, if my main market is in Paris, France, If I start from Thessaloniki, how easy it is to expand to Paris? Yeah, it's maybe easier to expand to Athens. Is that okay or not? You should start thinking about stuff like that. And initially, we should always start from the target group that fulfills the most criteria, the higher ranks and scores based on the evaluation that we have done on the axis that we've discussed about before. Yeah, so you need to try to understand who is the first customer that you have to start with and focus your resources on those guys. Yeah. Let's move. So we have performed some work in understanding the problem, some desk research in understanding the problem and the numbers. We have performed some work on understanding the competition, the alternatives, and we believe that we have a clear idea about who our customers are. Next, we go to the concepting phase, where we start working a little bit more systematically. Go. So here, first things first, do your homework. Homework means what we've said so far. Now, business model canvas, I leave the floor to Nikos.
Okay, so one of the main tools that we use when we're starting a new venture, any kind of venture for startups specifically, is the business model canvas. Traditionally, when you started a business, you needed to create a business plan, go to the bank, get a loan, and so on and so forth. But if you boil down this, the whole process is about understanding what you're doing, what kind of value you are creating, and for whom. So the business model canvas is one of the cornerstone tools that you use when you start up. So you can map all of your knowledge on a piece of paper and then use it as a guide to help you go through your next steps. If you could, next slide, please. So the business model canvas, the way it's created, it goes from right to left, starting with the customers. As Stefanos said, who are the people you're going to help? And when you understand the kind of segments and the kind of customers you are helping, then you have to define what kind of value you have to convey to them. So you go to the value provided. How do you help these people? Now, in order to convey that kind of value to your customer, you need channels. What the channels is how they know you and how you deliver that kind of value to your customers. And of course, once you deliver your kind of value, then you go to customer relations. How do you interact with them? How do you support them? How do you make sure that their lifetime value, which is one of the key metrics in any business, is significant enough? Once you do all that, once you map all that to your business model canvas, then you have to see, okay, in order to do that, what are the key activities that I need to do to perform in order to convey that kind of value through the right channels to the right customers? And once you know the key activities that have to be performed, then you need to know, do I have the resources or what kind of resources, key resources am I going to use? Of course, you are not alone in that, which means that most of the time you look for key partners, and key partners are not only people that will help you, but also companies that may give you their services in order for you to fulfill your goal. Logistic companies is one example that I can think of. And of course, in a business model canvas, you have to define what are your main costs or your most evident costs, and then of course define what kind of revenues and benefits you're going to get out of that process, because at the end of the day, it's a business you are creating and you need to know your costs and your revenues and define whether this can be viable in the future. Next slide, please. So let's take an example of a service that most of you, I guess, know. We're talking about Uber. Uber has two main segments. It has riders, people who need a ride, and it has drivers, people who want to earn money by driving the riders, the people who need a ride. So this was the initial premise of Uber, right? Who are our customers? It's this kind of people, this kind of segments. Now, what's the value proposition, though, that we can convey to these customer segments so that it makes sense for them? Next slide, please. So the value proposition is we will create a platform that will connect riders with drivers. So far there hasn't been any platform that connected riders and drivers. You could obviously call a taxi or hail a taxi on the road, but there was no platform to connect those two. So for the riders, we need the easiest way to get around, anywhere, anytime. So wherever they are, they can just use their app and call for a driver. We need it to be low cost, yet not lose on the luxury of a taxi. And we need various levels of services that we can provide to them. Now, on the other hand, the drivers, there's a core value proposition for them. You will earn money when you are able to drive someone around. So it means that at your own time, at your own pace, you can earn as much money as you work for. So that was a key value, the key value proposition for these two different segments. And as you can see, they are color coded. So in the business model canvas, it allows us to systematically map down everything that needs to be done. What are going to be our channels, the Uber app, what's the customer relationships, a rating system so that everybody knows what kind of people they're working with. What are the key activities? Develop the platform, do the marketing, hiring drivers, operations, key resources, the tech platform, the driver network, talented employees, the brand is a key resource for a company like that so that people can gain trust, and so on and so forth, defining key partners, cost structure, and revenue systems. Next slide, please. So the next one is screen learn adjust, which I suppose is something that Dimitris can tell you more about. It.
I think that's Stefanos.
Stefanos, is it? Okay, so yeah, it's the assumption for this.
So for me, that's the main essence of the whole lean startup methodology, yeah? So Steve Blank, which is...
Sorry, one question. Can everybody hear the music in the background? No? Okay, that's good. Because there's a guy with an accordion.
So Steve Blank, which is one of the main...
Figures in the space.
Figures, yeah. Actors in the space of the new methodologies regarding innovative entrepreneurship. He says that no business plan can survive the first contact with the customer. So up to now, we have studied a little bit our market and our competition while being on in front of our computers. And we have set up our business models using the business model canvas, and we have performed some other analysis, putting ideas into place. But we need to understand that all these are just assumptions that we have, and we need to get the feedback from the customer. Let's move to the next. Yeah, so yeah, all of that up to now, it's really a set of hypotheses. Yeah, we haven't tested any of them. We are not sure that the customer segments are really interested about the value propositions that we've set. We're not sure about many things. So the assumption methodology validation says that the assumption validation methodology, in fact, consists of three main steps. Once that we have the BMC, we need to identify and map the most crucial assumptions that we are currently doing. People who drive their cars would be willing to drive their cars around in order to get some extra revenue. We need to design experiments to test those assumptions, and then we need to run the experiments with our customers to see whether or not they are valid or not. There are mainly three categories of assumptions that we need to have in mind and try to test. The most important are the desirability-related assumptions, which concern the value proposition, the customer's part of the BMC. There are the feasibility assumptions. So the desirability assumption is do our customers actually care about that? Would they be willing to pay about that? The feasibility assumptions regard the top left side of the BMC.
whether or not we are actually able to build something like that. And the viability assumptions regard the bottom part of the BMC. And the main question is, can that be a viable business? Can we make enough money to cover our costs and expand? So you need to have assumptions regarding all these three parts of the BMC, and you need to be sure that the assumptions that you are doing regarding all these three cases are correct and are valid before moving on, in order to have some chances of achieving the product market fit, of achieving, in fact, having a product in the market where people in the market are actually paying and buying that product. Now, one of the first tools that we use is that we need to define assumptions, as we've said, regarding the desirability, feasibility, and viability of the case. And once we have the list of assumptions regarding most parts of the BMC, we need to evaluate each assumption in relation to its uncertainty and its impact. Not all assumptions have the same impact on the business model, and we have not the same certainty level regarding all assumptions that we are doing. We're going to see some examples later, and it's going to be a little bit better understood. But you have to remember here that two main axes where we evaluate the assumptions: the uncertainty, how certain I am that the assumption is valid, how certain do I feel that there are drivers that they would be willing to drive around strangers in order to get money, how certain am I about that, and how big is the impact in case that the assumption is not valid. So if this assumption, if there are no drivers willing to drive around and move strangers around, if this assumption is not true, how big is the impact on the BMC? In that case, it's highly impactful. I mean, the impact is big. But if it's going to be, if the assumption is that I'm going to reach my customers via Facebook advertising, then the impact is not the same. Yeah, you have alternatives. What is this slide?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So moving to the next, you want to start in the next phases where you actually test the assumptions. You want to start from the most important, and the most important are the ones that have a big impact and you feel highly uncertain about those. So once we have the most important assumptions of our model, we need to pick the riskiest ones. And we need to brainstorm some tests about how we could actually test that without building a product first. Yeah, that's the main concept. Yeah, you need to save money, you save time, and try to figure out to test the assumptions. So you define the testable hypothesis, you set some smart goals, and then you run the test and you review results. The strategizer, and we need to define what is a smart goal. Yeah, when we set a goal regarding each experiment that we're going to perform or each test, a test would be that we're going to run some interviews, or we're going to send some questionnaires, or we're going to demonstrate a pilot in a number of customers. You want to be specific. Yeah, you want to be specific. Use numbers as much as you can and set goals before running the experiment. And the goals must be SMART. SMART means specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time boxed. Yeah, you want to say that I'm going to run 100 interviews. I will measure that by the interviews, whatever. This, whatever.
50%.
Yeah, yeah. You want to set achievable targets. I want to run 100 interviews. Yeah, maybe this is achievable, maybe not. But I want to run 100,000 interviews.
that's definitely not achievable and neither realistic. And you want
if you have 50 years.
Yeah, and you want to have a time frame, yeah? So in the next week, I want to run 10 interviews. Yeah, this is specific, this is measurable, this is achievable, realistic, and time-boxed. I'm going to run 100,000 interviews. This is not a smart goal, yeah? When are you going to run them? Is it realistic? Is it achievable? So there are various tools that you can use in order to set up your experiments. We present here one used by the Strategizer, which is a platform who provides different tools. And I believe those are the same creators of the BMC, of the BM Business Model Canvas. And the structure that they suggest is that you start by defining the hypothesis. We believe that X, Y, Z is true. To verify that we will do X, Y, Z, whatever, we're going to measure that and we are right, meaning that the assumption is valid if X, Y, Z. Let's say an example.
An example, okay. So there's let me make sure there's video. I'm sharing audio. Just give me a second, please. I'll share my screen again. Apologies for this, just a second. Just make sure you can see my YouTube video in full screen mode. All right, can you see YouTube?
Yes, we can see Dimitrios.
Okay, let me know if you can hear as well.
No, we cannot hear it.
So let's discover the test card together. This is a tool that allows you to describe how you're going to test the hypothesis. So let's look at an example together. Let's give this test a course. We're going to call it Pricing the Value Proposition Design Course, and we're going to assign it to Natasha, who basically does the testing and the data at our company. But let's move to the first block here, the hypothesis.
Okay, let me just add that this specific example, so this is Osterwalder, who is the person who came up with the business model canvas concept, and he's now giving an example of designing an online course which is meant to help people who design new products. And he's explaining how they would be able to validate their business idea with a test card.
Here you describe one thing that has to be true for your idea to work, and you're going to select one hypothesis among the many that you have to test your ideas. So let's fill this out for our example. Let's take a specific case here. We said we believe that people are willing to pay $500 for a self-service value proposition design course. This is a hypothesis that we had that we wanted to test before designing, before filming the course. And here we have one more thing. We describe if this is a critical test or not. In this case, before we actually tested the pricing, we of course tested if people even wanted the course. Now let's move to the next block here, the test itself. So we're going to describe here what we're going to verify, what we're going to test. In our case, we said, to verify that, we will simulate the sales of the online course on our website. That was a test we're going to perform. And here we have to describe, of course, how much this test costs. Let's circle that in our case. And we have to describe how reliable the data is. Let's circle that for this case. If you talk to people, it's kind of a test, but the data is not really reliable because you know that people don't always do what they say. But here we're simulating a purchasing situation. So the data is pretty reliable if that will really correspond to the reality later on in the future. Okay, now let's move to the next thing here. What are we going to measure? So in our case, we said we're going to measure how many of the visitors who come to the website will actually convert. So that was the particular measure that we looked at to validate or invalidate our hypothesis. And now let's move to the last thing here that you also want to define in your test, the threshold. If your hypothesis was true or false. In our case, we said, we are right if, with our hypothesis, if the conversion rate of this course is at least as good, at least as big, at least as high as the conversion rate that we had for our last course that sold at $500, the business model generation course. So here we have it, a great tool to structure your testing, to structure your experiments, to figure out if your beliefs, the things that have to be true for your idea to work, actually are true in reality.
All right, so with this video, we've been going for over half an hour now. It might be good to now say that, you know, if you have any questions, you can use chat to send the questions, or you can just unmute and jump in and interrupt and you know, ask a question about something that's unclear. So we've introduced a structured process to think about assumptions, think about the business model, think about assumptions from different aspects of that business model in terms of desirability, feasibility, and viability. And then these two different axes, how impactful an assumption would be if it didn't hold on our business model, and how much we know, how certain or uncertain we are. And now we've introduced this four-step process to define experiments. Any questions so far? Okay, if you have questions, if you'd like clarifications on any of the examples given, just use chat, please. All right. Okay, so Petros is good, and Christina doesn't have any questions, okay. All right, so guys, please feel free to ask questions. It's no worth, having this presentation unless it's helpful.
Okay, can I ask a question? I wanted to ask is how much time we may or can dedicate for, you know, for validation or each part of this process that we are doing when we are developing our business ideas. How do you think? Are there some kind of time constraints that we need to work on or say stop and go further or change idea? How do you think?
Please go ahead.
Okay. The time that you're going to spend on experimenting and identifying whether your business idea makes sense or not is another experiment. So if you have 1 year to spend on it, then you must do everything within 1 year. If you have 3 months to spend on it because you don't have enough money, you have to get a job, or because you have to get a second job or whatever, it doesn't really matter, then it's going to be 3 months. So depending on the time that you have available to yourself to examine and identify whether your idea has a potential to go out to the market is the time that answers your question. So that's pretty unique to everyone, to everyone's circumstances, basically. Mm-hmm. Urgency, just to finish up what I'm saying, in this field, urgency is a must. So if you're going to do something, you have to do it fast, correct, with the right tools and the right way of doing it and all that, and get results fast. so you can fail fast if you're going to fail, right?
And again, it's a case-by-case basis, because if your validation experiment depends on what your competition is doing, then you have to move faster than your competition. So this is your time restraint.
It also has to do with what we want to gain out of it. Stefano, go ahead.
Yeah, plus if you allow me to just add something, I don't believe that you can easily put a time frame, because it's a continuous process, yeah? And in reality, it never stops, yeah? You start by performing interviews with no development whatsoever, with the most crucial assumptions that you need to validate in order to start, and then you move step by step. After several steps, you will have a complete company and a complete product ready, but you will still have assumptions, other kind of assumptions, yeah?
Or enough data to fail.
Yeah, either case. So it's a process that never actually stops. It changes the nature of the assumptions that you have, yeah?
Yeah, there is the risk of paralysis by analysis. So, you know, going into a never-ending process of collecting data, yeah, which is something I'm famous for, you know, over-analyzing things. But the thing is, it also, I believe it has to do, so first of all, it's case by case. And then how do you judge each case? I think it's about your, how much you put at risk.
So, hi from Nikki. So in your case, how much did it last before you start your company?
How much did what?
In your case, what was the time frame you spent on this?
Well, let me give you one example. Let me start maybe with a direct opposite example in terms of business. So Stefanos is running a hardware.
Let me say my story. Say about good video, and then we'll do that.
Okay then. Well, completely different story. So Stefanos is a mechanical engineer, and he has this business he explained in the beginning. I am a software engineer, and in 2014 we started a company with the idea to develop a piece of software, an online platform that marketers could use to introduce video content inside video galleries, inside e-commerce websites, such that they would present products in a much more interesting way to customers and hopefully convert more customers and more visitors into buyers. Completely different kind of business. In my case, we started with a startup competition, and our first feedback, when one of the judges was a marketing a person who said, he was a judge at Startup Weekend in Sheffield, and he said, last week I spent 20 hours looking for video content for a customer of mine who runs an e-commerce site. If that thing existed, I would buy it right now, he said. So my validation was about done. At that point, I thought, great, this guy is a judge. He knows what he's talking about. He's my persona. He's my kind of customer. And my co-founder and I went ahead and started the company because we had the sample of one, and one was good enough, right? Because the person was only confirming our story, our idea. That sounded very nice, and so we didn't need any further validation. I would have done it differently now. So what happened with this company is we started. So there are experiment types later on. We started investing our own money into developing an initial version of the product, one without the really hard software engineering work to be done ahead. Just the cheapest stuff done first that customers would see. Our customers were marketers, and their customers were, consumers. So we started building there. So we did some things correctly. We, just to move forward, because this is a long story, 3.5 years later, about over €1 million spent, including venture capital funding, 800,000 euro, our own funding, a few hundred thousand euro of sales, and we had about 50 customers. we managed to build something, so it was feasible to build it. It was desirable enough because we had 50 customers from different parts of the world paying for it every month, and some of them on annual, but it wasn't viable because we never managed to break even. And the cost of maintaining that service could only be met with a much larger market size, which we didn't have. The size of the market wasn't large enough, so we failed for the same reason that was on slide number 3, which is no market need. Of course, no market need is not an exact term. There's always market need. There will be some market, even for your craziest idea. If you think about the most crazy type of product, in a world of 7 billion people, there will be at least one person who will be thrilled about your stupid idea and will pay money to get it. And that's a market of one. So there is a market. So no market need is not right. I mean, that doesn't make sense, right? But yeah, you need a market that's large enough to sustain your business into viability. So to answer your question, Nikki, I'm not sure. In my case, it took over €1 million to arrive at the conclusion that this couldn't be viable.
Yeah, but you see the steps, right? Yeah, they started with some things and then they moved, and then it's a continuous process. In my case, for example, yeah, which it's a heavier thing, literally speaking. Mm-hmm.
It weighs tons of metal. Yes, tons of metal. Yeah. It's no
20 code. Tons of metal, yeah. So we started like a decade ago, like with some stops in the middle. We spent like 3-4 years working full time, performing research in the university. A lot of money spent as well, more than €1 million, but it was not our money. We didn't care.
Which was about.
Yeah, I mean, it was research grants and stuff like that. It was far more than €1 million. We worked for 3-4 years developing the core technology, and mm-hmm. we arrived at the point where we said we had a proof of concept. Yeah, it was a feasibility related thing. We didn't know that it was it was named like that, but it was a feasibility related thing. Does this thing work? I mean, can it work? So we had some first data that were suggesting that yes, it can definitely work. Then participating to some ideas competition and stuff like that, we participated in one of the world's biggest accelerator programs in the Netherlands, the Climate Kick Accelerator Program. It's maybe the most important accelerator in the world regarding hardware and clean tech technologies and ventures. This is a big program. This is a 3+6+9 months program, all about validation. Yeah. So there, the main part, which was approximately a year, we didn't spend a second developing the technology, and it was all about the market. So we performed more than 100 interviews with potential customers from various market segments. We understood that, okay, wineries is a market segment that we are interested in. So we then expanded a lot our interviews with them. We started exchanging data. We built a model in order to try to understand the numbers. And that was desirability related assumptions. So we had validated some of them. Then we performed a lot of work on the business model and the viability related assumptions. How much could this thing cost, and how much would the customers be willing to pay for that? So we were pretty confident on the viability related assumptions as well. And now we had to get back. Once we had all those ready, we said, okay, now we are pretty confident. Now the next most crucial assumption is a feasibility related assumption, is how much this thing will cost, not to build, but to operate and to run for a long period of time. Yeah, we have a prototype in the university, but as an actual product, how much will it cost? But in order to do that, we had to form the company, find private money, and stuff like that. So during the past 2-3 years, we spent approximately $500,000 to build the first unit in order to test this assumption. Yeah, and we are still not yet in the market. Yeah, but this is like the last most crucial assumption. If this assumption is valid, then we are ready to go in the market. If this is invalid, then we are not ready to go in the market. We are ready to close the thing, yeah? But it depends. And because even if we go to the market, then we are going to have other kind of assumptions that we will have to find ways to test efficiently.
So it's one model, it's one way of thinking about what will be more likely to end your entrepreneurial effort in the least glorious way. so you need to think about what would be more likely to cause failure, and what would be the type of failure that I would find it difficult to forgive myself for overlooking. For not realizing it's there, and it was lethal, and it was staring me in the eyes, all along, and I chose to ignore. So it's a way of thinking about risk and prioritizing your efforts to understand and remove uncertainty, and it's different with different business models. But it works with the same process for everything.
Yeah, and the idea is how can you test that as soon as possible, yeah? It's not always there, yeah? And Nikos, for example, story is an interesting one with a completely different kind of assumption. But he doesn't want to share that, so...
I can share it. If we have time, I can share it.
Okay, so... what do you think we go through different experiment types, Stefan, and then we break for 5 minutes before we provide an example of assumption validation with Airbnb?
Sorry?
Okay.
I would say we go through this slide with different mm-hmm, experiment mm-hmm. types, and then we break for 5 minutes.
Okay. The way we have a question here by... Georgi, I'm not sure if I spelled that correctly. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. How do you define the red line where you have to stop planning and start doing acting? The idea is that you want to start doing acting as soon as possible, but
because it costs, you have to do it clever.
Yes,
in a clever manner. Yeah. So this is exactly the kind of slide that answers this question.
Yes, exactly. And then apart from the recording, can we have the PPT presentation? I believe yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So exactly on how, what do we mean by acting? Yeah. This slide has the main information. Yeah. By experimenting, by testing things in the market, sitting on your house and planning has some value because you need to understand some stuff, but then you want to go out of the building, as they say, and act as soon as possible. And there are various types of experiments, as we see here, and you can brainstorm with your teams and colleagues and other people, what other hundreds or tens of other kinds of experiments as well. Just to give you some highlights, yeah? There is, this slide comes from the Board of Innovation. They have a lot of interesting material about what we are discussing now. But some ideas about experiments is that, yeah, instead of customer interviews are the basic ones, yeah? It costs nothing, you don't need to develop anything, you just need to go out and speak to your customers. We're going to say some stuff about how to speak with your customers later in the presentation, yeah? Then another typical example is the smoke test.
Sorry, you mean potential customers, okay? Yes. I guess,
yes. Okay. Potential customers, of course. Yeah, then you have what is called the smoke test. Yeah, instead of it's something similar to what the guy in the video, Osterwalder, said, yeah? That instead of building the thing, building the video material and the training and blah, 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 and investing resources of building it, we said that it's ready and we tried to sell it through the website. Yeah, we were lying, but it's no problem. Yeah, it's you can lie a little bit if you are kind enough to say, excuse me, I'm sorry, but we're not ready, blah, blah, blah. If you're going to actually get the data that you need. Yeah. Another thing regarding mainly hardware and stuff like that, people building things that cost a lot to build, you can go with a letter of intent. Yeah, for example, ourselves, before raising the funds to start building the pilot unit now, we had already signed some letter of intents from potential customers saying that, okay, if you bring me that and it has 1, 2, 3 characteristics, I'm willing to buy at that price and at that payment terms. You can do explainer videos, you can do a lot of stuff, yeah? But the idea is how you can simulate the process, the end process, as soon as possible and at the lowest cost possible. And we have some examples as well.
Crowdfunding is a very good example, for instance, for companies that create tangible products, like, I don't know, a bag or sunglasses or something like that. Creating a product, a tangible product, takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of money and so on. So a crowdfunding campaign does what? You create a prototype, maybe, or a design of it, and you say, I'm going to have this out. It has this kind of features, and it's going to be out at this price. And if you take it from here, it's going to be at an
reduced price.
So basically what you're doing is that you are pre-selling in order to see if there's enough interest. That's why crowdfunding campaigns usually have a cap. And the idea is for tangible products that if I don't reach this cap, let's say 20,000 euros, then I'm not going to produce it. I'm going to return the money to everyone. So there are a lot of ways of acting, and you have to find the cheapest possible with the most meaning for you, right?
Yeah. And this case is super interesting. Me too, I like a lot of crowdfunding, because you have to understand that when we're talking about business to customer, yeah, when we're talking about hardware, which is not heavy hardware, B2B stuff like the one I'm doing, and it's sunglasses, for example, yeah, it's easy to build one, yeah, and it's easy to design one, but in order to set up all the manufacturing at scale that these kind of models require, it's a lot of cost in terms of money and time. So this crowdfunding thing says that, okay, before investing on building the partnerships, getting the deals done and stuff like that, designing all the manufacturing process, go first on the market and get the feedback from the market. And that's
the buying for the market.
The buying from the market. About it. Yeah. We have some examples, but we can have a break and then go to the examples. Yeah.
I think we've been on the call for 1.5 hour. Nikki, how would you like to?
We can vote, actually. I mean, if people are okay and they prefer to continue, why not? It would be very nice if you, in parallel, you give an example of your experience. But what you just did, it's very nice to hear, I mean, the theory and your experience side by side, I think. So if people are okay with that, let's ask participants, are you okay with, do we need a break for 5 minutes or are you happy?
So anyone who's who needs a break, you just type in break.
Okay. I don't need a break. I'm happy. You see.
Okay. I don't see the rest of the answers.
If you feel like that as well, I'm okay. You see, as well.
Yeah. The others are already in a break.
No. You see, some people have exams, so they need to. We have exam period now in Greece and probably in most.
Right. Let's proceed and make sure we stick with the time frame then.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And probably we can finish a few minutes earlier. So yes, if no break, okay.
All right. So that's the main idea.
Fail fast, fail cheap, fail often, fail in a way that doesn't kill you. Dimitri.
Okay, so what we want to do is to embrace failure. If we have to find our way, we need to understand that we are about to discover that many of the things we thought would probably work will not work. And that's absolutely okay, because it's impossible for anything that's complex enough for one person to think about all the different things that would need to be true, and for that person to be right 100% of the time. We will not be right about most things, because we are approaching something with limited knowledge, and we're about to gain much more knowledge. That's a visual representation of what this fail fast and fail cheap and fail often and fail in a way that doesn't kill you. What this means is this is the path that we would follow in a case where there's not much uncertainty about what we're trying to build. So this is the waterfall approach versus the lean approach. Now, this is borrowed from the software engineering space, where what we're being taught as software engineers is that in projects that are where the problem to be solved is quite well understood, there's not much uncertainty. If it's building a website, for instance, which is the simplest thing. If you've done it already 50 times, then and you have the 51st project, well, it's very clear. You've done it 50 times already. There's not much uncertainty. You will use probably the same technology stack, and you will do the same things again and again. You will just execute something you already know, a recipe that you already know. How much risk is there? How much uncertainty? Not much. In this case, you can also project how much effort it will take to build something. And you understand what's the part of the whole project that you know well, and what are the parts that you don't know well. And this is the case where we build in a waterfall approach, meaning we plan all the way and we execute. Now this is a very very reasonable thing to do in a domain where there's not much to know. It's a very well known subject. Now, in places, in space, in projects where you have lots to learn, and it's the territory is unknown, it's not wise to proceed in this way. It's like if I was a person who has never built a payment system, let's say, for example, with the complexity of PayPal. I'm using PayPal because everyone knows the PayPal payment system, right? I have never built anything like this, me myself. Now, if you ask me to plan and tell you, what I need to do and how much it will cost and when it will be delivered, I will be faced with a very, very difficult problem, because I cannot predict. The way I would do it is I would break it down into smaller iterations where I would learn, and I would move in a way that's more like the right side of this slide, the lean approach. I would run small experiments, and I would learn my way through. And anyway, I explained this in software engineering terms, but they're probably not being very well understood. Let's go back to the business project example. So I have a business project, I have a business idea. What I can do is I can write a business plan, which is 80 pages long. And it explains everything that will happen along the way, Now I have my 80 pages done. I know what will happen. I've already prescribed it. And I will go ahead and I will build and start building the product, building the channels, building the way to you know, have customer relationships, building the team, building the infrastructure, building everything, and then launching the product. And then because of building, I have acquired lots of risk because I'm assuming too many things that may or may not prove correct, which will mean that if I fall from that height, I will probably get killed. Now, if I were to approach this in a different way, I would run experiments to understand more about what I'm doing, I would validate desirability first. I would run a small experiment to do that. I would gain some knowledge. If I'm wrong, the type of risk I've assumed will not kill me. The distance is not that high, and I will proceed with, in smaller iterations that will make it least likely for me to run out of time, run out of money, or run out of energy. And let's see an example here now with Airbnb. The original name was Air Bed and Breakfast. I'm not sure how many know the story where Airbnb comes from. It's about airbed, which are inflatable beds. And let's see how this company started. And let's look at an example of how assumption validation could be applied in their case. Now this is their BMC. So the Airbnb is a company that's meant to address two different customer segments. One is guests who initially in 2008, these were budget travelers. These were budget travelers. They were all people, you know, who were travelers in general, and or people visiting one city for a particular business purpose. So on one hand, the guests, and on the other hand, the hosts. These would be locals who want to get some money from renting out their home. And what is the value proposition for these guests? It would be that they could stay at a private home during their travel and get to know the locals and have a local experience and have someone who can tell you about the city, a much more personalized service compared to staying in a hotel. And it would be also cheaper. So that's the value proposition for the guests. And for the hosts, it would be the ability to rent out their home or their sofa or an airbed without any effort and get money. Now, when it launched Airbnb 2008, this is one of the, this is in a forum where the founder announced this. This is one of the comments that were given as a reply to the founders. So this guy, Mr. Jeffries, and this, of course, this figure is not from 7 years ago, it's from 2008. So it was taken in 2015. It says, one of the things he said is, if this ever becomes mainstream, Airbnb, the whole thing will come crashing down. Because the kind of people who are robbers, abusers, rapists, and murderers, they will start using it. And that will spread legitimate fear. And he said, pray that this remains underground. That's the only way it can survive. That was this guy's comment about Airbnb. So it seems that history proved this guy wrong. But if you remember the different types of audiences in the chasm, so this person would probably be with the laggards. Those people who are part of the mainstream market, they wouldn't be early adopters. They're not the early market. They're in the mainstream market. And they are the least prepared to adopt this kind of very novel, very innovative kind of offering. So what was the riskiest assumption that the Airbnb founders would need to validate? It's that people would actually be ready to pay money to sleep in a stranger's home. That was the assumption with the highest impact and the highest uncertainty. Highest impact because if this assumption didn't prove to be true, didn't prove to hold, there was no business for Airbnb. It was the foundation of the business model, the value proposition. Because you know, no one would be, even if people existed out there who would be willing to open their doors and let strangers come in and you know sleep at their extra bed, if there was no one willing to pay for this type of service, then they didn't have a business. So this is the desirability from the demand side. And why is it that they had least certainty about this assumption? They clearly because it had never been done before. So up until now, what we know is, you know, when we up until 2008, when people traveled, they would need to rent an apartment from a company or rent a hotel room. So there was no data, nothing to suggest that people would be willing to pay money to sleep in a stranger's home. Now in 2020, if the same team started building, you know, something of that nature, something similar, there will be the certainty would be much higher. It wouldn't be equally uncertain because we now have Airbnb and we know that people are okay. They will pay money to sleep in a stranger's home. Airbnb, a competitor to that new business, which is just starting out this year, has already validated that. So it also depends on, you know, what we know about a business model out there in the world. So, yeah, that was the founder's riskiest assumption. Now, I would like to ask to please open your mics, and no, I don't think we have time for this. Let's go ahead. Let's go ahead with a full example. So going back to the the experiment design card, how would we state the hypothesis? The hypothesis is, when we state it in this way, we believe that people will actually pay money to sleep in strangers' homes. To verify that, we will put three air beds, three inflatable beds in our apartment and set up a website advertising cheap accommodation on air beds with a no frills breakfast. So I'm explaining what these guys did, what the founders of Airbnb did. These were two designers from New York who had recently moved into San Francisco in 2000, a year before they launched the company. They were very, they needed cash. They were running out of money. And they thought about Airbnb as a way to solve their own problem of making money by offering to accommodate people in their apartment. So they thought they had two inflatable beds. They had two air beds and they bought the third one. And they said, and they put up this website, which said this exact thing. Cheap accommodation on airbeds with a no frills breakfast, which means nothing fancy as a breakfast. And they did this because there was a design conference coming up in San Francisco called the Industrial Design Conference. And they wanted to see if there would be interest by those people visiting the city on the occasion of that conference to book. And so the third step in the experiment is, and measure how many visitors to the San Francisco Industrial Design Conference will book. And they said, we will consider ourselves right and that we will have data that suggests that yes, people will actually pay money to sleep in strangers' homes if we get at least three guests at $80 per night. So they wanted to have all three air mattresses booked for the duration of the conference. And this is what actually happened. So they sent a few emails to friends they knew from New York with a link to their very quick website. And what they got back was hundreds of emails with CV attached, with curriculum vitae attached, so small resumes, explaining, you know, who they are. So they were actually people, strangers, were actually trying to convince the owners of the flat, the founders of Airbnb, to you know, pick them and allow them to sleep on their air mattress. What they got back was hundreds of emails, and yes, there were three guests that they chose. If they had a few tens of air beds, they would still be able to sell these as well. And this is what an early version of Airbed and breakfast looked like in 2008, and that's an even, I think that's a slightly later version, where there was just a map of San Francisco. That was the first city, and what you could see is when you landed on airbedandbreakfast.com, you would see the dots on the map, the pins on the map where apartments are available, and the reviews. So 1 out of 10 of 16 listings in San Francisco, that was all. That's a very early print screen. So let's have a look at this video that summarizes this. Can you see my video in full screen?
Yes, Dimitri, it's okay.
Okay. It's forever loading, sorry about that. In a second, please.
How Airbnb. How Airbnb started, or how three guys went from renting air mattresses to a $10 billion company. Two guys in San Francisco couldn't pay rent. So they thought, why not rent out three air mattresses? They made a simple website, a blog with maps. Two men and a woman showed up paying $80 each. After guests left, they thought, this could be a big idea. They invited a former roommate, Nathan, as a co-founder to build the site. Then they launched at South by Southwest and got two bookings.
Brian, I hope it's not the only idea you're working on.
So in 2008, they sold Obama O's cereal right before the election for $40 a box. They got their first money, $30,000. In 2009, they got $20,000 in first funding from Paul Graham's Y Combinator. They were making $200 a week for months, not growing much. Finally, they realized photos of places were not so pretty. So they went door to door in New York City and took photos by hand of listed houses. 1 week later, they were making $400 a week. Finally, they started growing. But they were still rejected by a famous VC in New York City, Fred Wilson. Then Barry Manilow's drummer rented out an entire house. Aha, they thought. Then they raised $600,000 in seed round from Sequoia Capital. 2010, they raised $7.2 million. 2011, $112 million from many investors, including Ashton Kutcher. And finally, 2014, Airbnb is valued at $10 billion. Now, don't you tell me you can't do a startup.
Sorry. So now don't tell me that you can't do a startup. Actually, the video is quite old. And Airbnb is not valued at 10 billion anymore. I think before coronavirus, it was valued at 45 billion. Now, of course, it's valued less. But it's nonetheless a very valuable company, as we all know. And there's more to this story. It's the way they quickly tested to validate their most critical, their most important hypothesis. And the way they persisted, despite the fact that the second time they ran this experiment on a different location at Austin in Texas, they only got 2 bookings, so it was a complete failure. They persisted. They tried something completely different. So this selling cereal boxes with the face of Obama for a Democrat conference in a city, that completely unrelated to Airbnb, but these guys were just trying to collect some money to invest in the Airbnb idea, which they did. And yes, they persisted through many, many failures. So their journey, it wasn't an easy one. But finally, they realized, photos are an important part of the experience. And the channel they go through, which is a website, needs to be enhanced through this nice photographic content. And this really helped to change their traction. So that's from me, Stefanos. Over to you.
Okay. Are you here? Yeah, sorry, we had to unmute and Nikos is a little bit slow. I'm not sure that I remember what we have in the rest of the slides. I think that the core of the presentation is finished. Yeah, okay. So, based on what we've said, just another notion that we have to just highlight here is the notion of the minimum viable product, which is in fact part of what we've said before. It depends on the definition. The definition that I like is that minimum viable product is whatever allows you to learn and get actual data from the market. Let's move to the next. Yeah. So again, it's the same thing. It's fully in line with what we've said before about the test and the experiments. And what we say is a popular strategy to test early and cost effectively, minimum features, and it allows you to investigate the acceptance and the purchase intent as a solution to a specific problem. And this may be a prototype, video explainer, concept board, landing page, etc. Again, fully in line with what we've said before. And as Dimitrios was saying, it's about instead of developing the product, a full product, we're now talking about developing minimum viable products, not a single one, but a plurality of products that starts growing and building into the full product that we had in mind in the beginning. So some examples of MVPs or experiments, as we've said in the beginning, is instead of building a full website, just build a landing page with the main features. Buffer is an interesting case. Buffer is a tool that allows you to schedule tweets on Twitter. So they build, instead of building the whole thing and start writing codes, hundreds or thousands of lines of code, they just build a landing page. This is the print screen of the landing page. They were saying that choose the times to tweet, add tweets to your buffer, and Buffer does the rest. Relax. That's the concept of the value proposition that we were discussing before in the BMC. And they added a button for plans and pricing. And they wanted to test the value proposition if it's being accepted by the customers. So
They built this thing and they were measuring how many people are visiting the landing page, how many people are pushing the button of plans and pricing. Next slide, please. Yeah, and on the next page, they had different plans, pricing plans, and they wanted to test, that's a part of the same experiment, but different test. They wanted to test the pricing related assumptions. Yeah, how many people were going to choose for 520 for these features. And they were also measuring how many people were going to select one or the, or one of those options. Next. And then, since there was nothing in place, they had just a closing message that, hello, you called us before, we're ready. Excuses and blah, blah, blah. We're working hard on building this thing and be with you soon. As we were saying before, as I mentioned, it's some people may say that, should I lie to my customers? It's not a lie, yeah. Be kind, be gentle, and be honest, yeah.
That we're just at the end.
Sorry?
Just be honest at the end of the process.
Yes, exactly, yeah. So,
no one is suggesting to actually go out and sell something that doesn't exist. They didn't accept money.
Yeah.
Okay, just to clarify this, they didn't take money. What they wanted is to test how prepared people were to go ahead.
Yeah. If you go to the next slide where we have the Dropbox, yeah? You're all familiar, I guess, with Dropbox. I don't know your backgrounds, but if we have any software engineers, etc., but building Dropbox, it's not an easy task. Yeah, building Dropbox, it's something like huge. So what Dropbox founder did, similarly with what we've discussed so far, is instead of building the thing, he just built a video, explainer video, describing how Dropbox would be, would operate and would be used. And he, again, built a landing page. He put the video on it. On the bottom of the video, he had a link, download Dropbox, which was not an actual option, and he wanted to see how many people will actually visit the site and see the video and push download Dropbox. Yeah, and he wanted to have this data before investing any resources and efforts to this super big project of building the actual thing. And the same applies also to hardware products by nature. Yeah, so as we were saying before, Segway is an example. In order to build the manufacturing processes of producing Segways is a big thing. So normally you start by a prototype, you want to demonstrate that, use it to take some pre-sales agreements, letter of intent or whatever, test the actual market and then move to the next step. Yeah, I think that we do not have a lot of information here about the MAM test, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, it's just that.
Dimitris has the link he can share with the people here.
Yeah, it's in the end of the presentation. There's a set of links. You will have the presentation.
Yes, we've mentioned before that we are going to discuss some things about how you perform interviews. Yeah, there is an interesting book, which is called the MAM test. It's a small book, it's like 90 pages or something like that. For me, it's my favorite. Yeah, there is a super interesting bibliography around lean startups and how you start and the process and stuff like that. There are like super, super good books. But my favorite, if I was to just to suggest just one, it's this one. It's a small book, 90 pages, it's a quick read, you can read it in a day. And it talks about only one specific thing, how you can talk to people in a way that you take the actual real information out of the conversation, how you can learn from an actual conversation. And the whole book builds on the scenario that you have an idea, you want to speak to your mom, And your mom, since she's not,
she's
your mom and she loves you and she wants to be nice to you, she lies to you without even knowing that she lies to you.
Unconsciously.
So the book says that, okay, people try to be nice to you, therefore they lie in front of your face without even realizing it. And that's a problem of how you lead the conversation. And the book works on that. How you should approach conversations, even with your mom, in order to get the actual data.
You don't tell your mom, "Mom, I have this great idea for a new business. Please tell me, would you buy this?" Now, this is the wrong way to do it. And the book explains what's the right way to do it.
Unless you have my mom, which would definitely say no. Get rid of those stupid ideas and just go to work.
Yeah, this is
depends on the mom.
Yeah, apparently American moms and Greek moms not operate the same way. Yeah, here they are honest. Go work. the main concept is that you want to understand, following on Dimitri's comment, yeah, you don't want to use hypothetical words. You don't want to ask about the future. You want to ask about the past. You want to understand what they have done in the past, what were their problems, what were the steps and the processes they've made, etc. You want to learn actual data, yeah? And now the final part of the presentation is the most disruptive idea ever. I give the floor to Nikos, if you want, yeah?
Yeah, well, this is an example that's from start to end and was provided to us by Dr. Adonis Livieratos from the University of Athens. So the idea here is that I want to start a business. Okay, I've got more space now. I want to start a business, and basically what I want to do is that I want to sell lemonades that are from bio lemons, obviously. I want to do that through a mobile app where people will obviously pay with Bitcoin because it's the new thing. And of course, they're not going to come to the store. These lemonades are going to be delivered with drones. So this is my most disruptive idea, right? But even so, you have to you are making some assumptions about the whole thing, right? One assumption is that people want fresh lemonade. Okay, maybe it's not the riskiest assumption. One assumption is that people will pay extra for organic lemonade. Online orders will increase consumption instead of somebody coming to the store. Consumers will pay more for delivery by drone because it's more convenient. Consumers are in locations where a drone can reach them, which means that I have a big enough market. Consumers prefer to pay by Bitcoin because, yeah, obviously they're accustomed to cryptocurrencies. But let's see how these things can be tested in a way that it doesn't ruin our budget, but provide us enough data to see if it's something we can move on. So we break this down into MVPs, right? As Stefano said, MVPs are a multitude of products up to the point where we reach the final value proposition that we want to convey. So the first MVP would be something simple. We would stand by the sidewalk with fresh lemon juice and see how many people would buy. A second step would be we would make a landing page and we would accept online orders with a typical delivery service with a delivery guy. A third MVP would be building a website and an app with an online ordering with a drone delivery in a particular neighborhood, because this is as far as we can go. And the final product would be a complete website, the app, online ordering and delivery with drones in an extended area, and probably pay with Bitcoins. So if we take these MVPs and break them down in what we are trying to verify, with MVP one, we try to verify that people want freshly squeezed lemonade. Okay, this is not our riskiest assumption, but let's see if they will take it from us. And the second one is that, moreover, they want to take organic lemonade and they're willing to pay more about that. The second one, we are adding that people would order online and they would prefer to pay with Bitcoin instead of regular currency. The third one, we are adding that people would pay more for a drone delivery And at the final product, we have all the features that we envisioned in the beginning. But going from one MVP to the next, the amount of money you're going to spend for a full product would probably be something like 350,000 euros and some like 1.5 years to make everything final. So instead of going up to that point with a waterfall approach and then see that nobody really wants what you've made and you're going to fall head down, head first, let's start with all the others. So the first MVP, building a stand where you can stay there for a week and try to sell lemonades, this will cost you some like 250 euros, maybe 250 euros. So that's an easy step to see if people would buy from you and if they would pay more for organic lemonades, which is one of your value propositions. The second one with online ordering and typical delivery would cost something more. You have to build a website, you have to have a payment processor and so on. So that would take about 1,500 euros. It would take a month. You have to build all that and then you have to make a campaign to advertise that. The third one where you have drones working and you have people that have to manage it, and of course maybe one drone is not enough. It would take something like 25,000 maybe and 6 months to make sure that everything works okay. And then you come to a point where if everything is validated, you can move on to a final product, ask for, you have enough data to go out and ask for investment, for instance, and you can go and spend 350,000 euros and 1.5 year to finalize that. But within this process, each step you make gives you enough data to see whether it actually worth moving on to the next step, right? So if all this is done and you have all the data and everything validates your assumption and this is actually the best, the most disruptive idea ever. I mean, imagine if we were back in 2008 and somebody said to me, Nick, what about opening up our houses so that people can pay and go, complete strangers come into our house and pay and stay in our bed? Would I say yes? I don't know. But if I wanted to test it, I would probably make it into small steps, like airbags. And this is one such example. So when you get to a point where you have enough data, you can actually launch a business. And when you launch a business, you're going out for the market. You're trying to see with small steps and pivots and adaptations and so on, test other assumptions, more elaborate assumptions, see how the market reacts, if you have growth, see what's going good, what's not going good, correct it, move forward. And of course, the end of the search phase, as we say here, is the start of the execution. The execution on its own is a very long process as well. It has to do with the market. There's so much more to learn from the market, and there's so much more that you can extract from how the market reacts. And if all falls into place, then you can scale up your business, move to more cities, move to more countries, and so on. So this is an overall process of how it works. So from BMC to assumption testing to a product in the global market, I guess Dimitris will tell you an example of our.
Okay, so that's the last, because we're already 2 minutes ahead of time, beyond our time frame. But that's a nice example. We'll show a few minutes of presentations of these guys. So Owlet, a startup founded in 2013. And actually this is, so by last year, what they had is over 50 million in revenues. They had two companies in the US and the EU. They were in both markets, over 120 employees. And they had secured over $48 million in venture capital funding, while also registering 8 patents for different innovations in the product. So what these guys built is a system that you can put on a baby to monitor the baby from your mobile device. Let's have a look. Okay, and you will see the steps they took. I'll leave on the Greek subtitles for those who are Greek on the seminar. Or should I not? So that's a business
model. We're out at Baby Monitors, and we want to share the story of how this sock is bringing...
Sorry, we don't have English subtitles. I can turn off Greek, but I don't think it makes a difference. So this is a business model competition where these guys explain the process they follow to validate their assumptions and change the design of the product.
Parents' peace of mind. So our story starts with Tanner working in the hospital. He works with the technology pulse oximetry. You've all seen this. It's a little red light they put on your finger, monitors your vital signs. He found working with this day in, day out, that there was a pain with it that he had experienced, and that pain was the cord. He found that patients didn't like it. He found that nurses didn't like it. It got tangled up. It got in the way. So he assumed that other nurses would feel the same way. So he went ahead to test that assumption. He thought, what if we had a wireless pulse oximeter? We could have nurses use it, and we could sell it through the hospitals. So in validating that, he went out and talked with 58 nurses. He found a really good response rate. 93% said they wanted to see this over the existing technology. However, going back to the hospital, talking with administrators, he got a very different story. This was not a pain for them. It was about money, and it wasn't cost-effective for them, and so they said no. So we learned a very valuable lesson. Your user is not always your customer. Even though we found a user that loved the idea and wanted to use it, they did not have purchasing power, and so going from the yellow, it goes back to red. It's unvalidated. So they're not our customer. We had to move on somewhere else.
A little closer, sorry.
Okay. This didn't cost a thing, and it only took about a week to validate. So we knew that we needed to pivot. Kurt Workman had experienced firsthand in his family the pain that comes from a child being lost to respiratory failure. And so he thought, what if we pivot, use the same technology in an in-home setting for infants? We can monitor vital signs, blood oxygen levels, heart rate, and report that to a parent, where if there's an emergency during the night, it will alert and alarm the parent, giving them peace of mind knowing that they'll have that type of alert. He had found, in addition, that SIDS is the number one cause of infant death in the United States. It's often respiratory related, which increases parents' anxiety a lot. In addition, there's 4 million babies born in the US every year. And so with that size, we figured and assumed that's a really big pain. I bet a lot of other parents feel this pain. So we went out to test that assumption. We started with our assumed solution, which was putting the technology into a smart anklet, putting it on the baby. It wirelessly would send that information to a relay station, which was capable of alerting and alarming the parents if there was an emergency, as well as pushing the information onto a smartphone for convenience. So we completely pivoted from our original idea. We started focusing on creating value in a new customer segment for parents in the home setting, helping bring them peace of mind. So we knew there was two types of risk we'd be facing in this: market risk, will someone buy it, and technology risk, can we build it? We tackled market risk first because it was easier to get to and it was more important. We initially surveyed 105 mothers, and we found that on average they gave us an 8.5 out of 10 on wanting this product, thinking the technology was great. 96% said that they would use this technology. We got a lot of responses like, this is awesome, I want to buy one now, and take my money now and start selling it. We knew this was very early validation, but it at least pointed us in the right direction. We really validated this idea when we took the idea into a class project, for which we built a website, we made a video. The video in reality at the time was nothing more than just smoke and mirrors showing what the product could be or what it could do. We put it up on the website, and it leaked out. We didn't intend for this, but it got picked up by 40 news agencies in 13 different countries. A lot of big names picked up this story. And because of that, we received over 500 emails in our inbox. Most of these were from parents begging for the product, saying, we want the peace of mind you provide. We're not sleeping well at night. We're willing to buy a prototype if that's all you have. And so from that, we feel we really validated that, yes, there is a pain here. These parents want the peace of mind that this can provide. In addition, we had 15 distributors around the world reach out to us. Among these, one from our major competitor said they're willing to drop that account, which brings them $2 million in revenue per year, to pick up our account. The second that's moving forward the fastest wants to do $50,000 in pre-sales to get this into their market the quickest. The great thing is all of that validation, it came from virtually building nothing at that point. And so we feel that indeed, yes, we did validate that there is a pain here and there is a customer that we can service. That only cost us $220 and took about 2 weeks to determine.
So our next question was, how are we going to reach our customers? We initially thought through hospitals, but after talking with pediatricians and mothers, we realized that the best place to sell it would be in the retail location. When looking at how much it was going to cost us to make our product, we realized that at the end, the customers would have to be buying it at around $200. Our question was, are we really creating that much value? So we originally thought and assumed that we would have to rent the product. Our initial survey was pointing us in that exact same direction. We got out of the building, went and talked to the people over at Babies R Us, and they told us there's a huge span of different products as far as price goes, and that the ones that were being purchased the most were in the $200 range. We didn't believe the lady when she told us this, so we called 33 other baby stores, and they told us actually the exact same thing. We were completely wrong. 71% of the baby monitors being purchased today are in the $200 to $200 or $250 price point. And we learned that surveys can also lie if you don't word it correctly. We were asking, what would you expect to pay? But when we started asking, what's the maximum you would pay? That completely changed the results that we were getting. We also A/B tested this on our website. People thought that they were purchasing the product when they clicked on the reserve button at different price points. This allowed us to find out what the elasticity of the demand was and find our demand curve and find that the profit maximizing price was at $299. So we, in fact, were proved wrong, and luckily we will be able to sell the product. This cost us $30 and 3 weeks. The next question was, could we build it? And that went right with our next technology risk. The two factors that we needed to prove out was pulse oximetry and wireless transmission in this usage. We first did wireless transmission because it was easier. We built the proof of concept. It cost us $300 and 7 weeks, and it was able to do everything that we wanted it to, even though it looked kind of ugly. After proving that, the next question was, can we create pulse oximetry specific for infants? So we went back to the hospital, we interviewed the nurses, we watched how they were using the product, or the current pulse oximeters, and we realized that our design wasn't going to work. For technical reasons, we had to switch to a more sock-like design. We tested that sock-like design with over 120 hours of testing. We did it in 26 different homes and 7 overnight tests with parents. We are happy to see that with our new design, we could in fact build it. It cost us $500 and 12 weeks on working on that. Our next question, which unfortunately we didn't learn this until later in the game, was that we needed FDA clearance on this product. And the first person we talked to said it was going to cost us over $1 million. We had to figure this out. We talked to 16 professionals. We even talked to the labs that we need to work through. And we know it's going to cost us at maximum $200,000 in 13 months. We validated that, and it only cost us $200 in 3 weeks. But at this point, this validation was really bittersweet. We said, man, is $200,000 in 13 months and all that liability really running lean before we can even get a product into a customer's hands? Could we not create something that will be more minimal and less risky and start with that in the market? What was holding us up was the alarm. Alarm plus pulse oximetry means that you need an FDA clearance. We thought, well, what if we scratch the alarm? What could we do? We said, well, we'd have the same product that, you know, would still give you all these really cool things, and we could play with that data really in a lot of interesting ways, and maybe we could call it our infant health tracker. This was completely unvalidated, so we had to go back and revalidate whether or not this product with that slight tweak would be different. So we grabbed our clipboards and we headed out to a bunch of retail locations, and we interviewed 81 people in person. We gave them 4 pieces of paper and said, which one would you buy if you had to? And they had to choose between our product and then the 3 other types of product that they can buy in those same price points. We were amazed when 20% of them said that they would choose our product. And we also learned so much about our customer. It's not a one-size-fits-all customer. In fact, we really kind of have a whole range of customers. On one side, we kind of have like our hippie-type mom that's a lot less worried about these types of things. And then you also have the moms that's on the opposite side of the spectrum. The ones that were less worried told us things like, and we kept hearing it over and over, I wouldn't want an alarm on this. This would drive me crazy. And it absolutely floored us, but we realized that our alarm version wouldn't even capture part of the market. And by starting with a health tracker that they liked already, we'd be addressing a completely separate market, not cannibalizing our own sales, and starting with something that was a lot less risky to begin with. As for the parents who weren't worried, we would launch our next product a few months down the road after we'd learned from some risk and avoided some risk with our first product. So that was validated, and we learned so much more about how our customer base is segmented out. This cost us nothing, and it took about 3 weeks to do. Moving forward, we still need to validate a few things. We need to validate whether or not there's a few other
Sorry, I think we can let the participants actually go through the rest of the video at their own time. For us, I think that's a great example of how you iterate, how you validate different types of assumptions, how you go back to the drawing board, start with a new value proposition, a new segment, new understanding, new experiments, new validation, and it's all driven by reliable data. The concept is to gather data you can lean on to make your decisions. And this company, that's one example of a company that by applying this thinking, they were able to launch in the market. They were able to raise the money they needed to get the FDA approval for the alarm product and go on and build a very successful company. So to sum up and close this talk, key takeaways. First of all, a startup is a team of people on a search mission. So it's a temporary organization. It won't be there forever. And the sole purpose of a startup is to search for a business model, which is viable and scalable. It's not there to execute a business model. So there's the search phase and the execution phase, which are the last two steps of the startup roadmap with launch and scale up. The first steps are always about discovery. And this is the way we need to think. Because in the beginning, what we have in our heads is just unproven assumptions about whether the product will be desirable by the customer segments we have in mind, whether it's feasible to build, and whether the market out there is large enough for us to deliver this to that market and do it in a way that allows the company to be profitable. And what startup founders need to have in mind at this stage, because this is a discovery game, is they need to discover the truth and they need to collect data they can rely on. It's better to have no data at all rather than have data which you cannot trust to make good decisions on. Because of the fact that the prime reason for failure in startups is limited market need, you would be in a better position to start with testing the assumptions on desirability and viability. That's true for most startups, unless what you have in mind is to market some kind of a miracle drug that cures cancer, or some kind of very science-based innovation where you would need to actually make sure you can deliver this before you get going, before you go out and test if there's a market for it. We've presented three tools you can use: the business model canvas, assumption mapping based on the business model canvas, and experiment design based on assumption mapping. And the combination of these three things equals validated learning. It allows you to move fast, iterate quickly, know more about the market, and fail fast, fail cheap, and fail in a way that doesn't kill you. That's all from us today. There's you will get the presentation. There's a list of links in the end of the presentation that you can use. And if you have any questions, we're happy to take questions.
There is no one asking, just but I will ask one question. So it was extremely, extremely interesting for me. So thank you very much for all the information you showed. Still, sometimes when you talk with entrepreneurs and young entrepreneurs, how they started, quite often they say, oh, by intuition. Oh, we didn't have time, we have idea, and we just started. So so what's your answer to this kind of emotional approach to the business, which quite often actually leads to not very successful results, but still sometimes it works with no structure, no business models, just, oh, I started, you know?
Well, I guess it depends on the business model, and I guess too much innovation hurts. So if you have a highly, highly, highly innovative business model that's never been done before, you are less likely to have success just by starting out. Now, if you have a business model in mind that's there's already proven demand for this business model, and it has worked elsewhere, well, it might work for you as well. I have few examples of companies that come to mind based on what you just said. The more innovative a business model is, So the higher the uncertainty in a business model, I guess the least likely is for such an approach to work. That's my take. I don't know, what do you guys have to say?
Yeah, I have to say that even the people saying that, it's not true. It's not true. There is no parthenogenesis. Intuition is a process that results from thinking laterally, consciously or unconsciously, of how things work, of how processes work, of what may be a problem or not. So at some point or another, you might have an aha moment, right? But it's not that you just had it. It's the end result of a process, even if it's unconscious. That's one thing. The other thing is that they started because they had an intuition, okay? But they didn't see it in the cards. It came out of a bad process that was there for a while. But they validated that and they moved forward. So it's not like, I had an idea and it worked because I had it. It worked because the market accepted it. Even innovation as a term is not, it only makes sense if it's widely accepted. For instance, the Western type of toilet seat is one of the greatest innovations ever. Pipelines, one of the greatest innovations ever. It's so widely accepted that it's considered market innovation. Creating something in the lab that you do it for a couple of months and then nobody uses it, I personally do not consider that innovative. I consider it to have a potential for innovation. So to sum up, there's no such thing as I just woke up with an idea. It's a bad process that leads you to a place where things click. And then the market decides whether that click makes sense or not.
My, I will be short, yeah. Henry Ford was saying that if I was going to ask my customers what they wanted, they would reply faster horses, yeah? Yes, definitely. And we don't say go ask your customers what they want. You need to understand your customers. Henry Ford understood that the problem that my customers face is that they want to move from point A to point B in a faster and more convenient way. That's the problem. So he designed a solution which solved that problem. Yeah, we don't necessarily say go ask your customers. We say try to understand what the problem is, one. And two, he didn't go to the bank to ask for a loan in order to set up the production facilities of all the cars, right from point zero. He first built his own car, something looking like a car.
Mercedes-Benz,
yeah. He tested that on the market, yeah. And then, so he had the MVPs, he had the test, all that was in place, yeah. But it was not called that way. But the essence is the same.
And just to say something else, if you were doing something in the 60s, like a new model of a car or something else, it would be easy to go into a market where it doesn't have enough solutions. If you try to do that now, the market is much more saturated with solutions because it's easy to do that, to do them. It's easy to test things, it's easy to build. It's easy to break down the market in different segments and get a piece of it. So yeah, if you were talking to people that are 60 years old and they had an intuition, I can accept that. But you know, things are getting much more complicated as we move along. It's the information age, everybody has information, everybody has access to tools. There's so many people trying, you know, so many different things.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you for the question. So, should we wrap this up? Nikki and Christine?
Yes, thanks. Thanks a lot for the quick journey through the startup journey and all these tools, the assumption for validating assumptions. And I think the last video, it must be seen by everyone. It's a very nice way, I mean, to close all this up and see what you were talking about through your presentation. I think it's a very interesting one. So most people actually want your presentation, and we will send it to them. It was very interesting for me. Thanks a lot for being with us. I do hope that the people that joined actually learned. And thanks again.
Thank you for the invitation.
For being there.
And you can, there are some links you can find us and you know, continue this conversation offline. So if anyone is interested, you know where to find us when you get your you get the presentation. So I'm stopping recording now.
Okay, thanks.